I would be enlightening you a bit about the concerned personality here, who I would shortly be welcoming here on the stage. Straight out of college, he has started his career at Magnon 2 decades ago. The 300-plus member Magnon Group today is part of Fortune 500 Omnicom Group. Of its three agencies, Magnon EG Plus, Magnon Designery, and Magnon Sankers, Vivek leads Magnon EG Plus across international markets, including North America, Europe, Australia, and Middle East, apart from India. Vivek was named Managing Director of Magnon EG Plus in 2014 at the young age of 33. This made him perhaps the youngest ever MD of multinational agency in India. He has been profiled as a case study in the bestseller book, 30-something CEO. And he will be speaking on the topic, Finding Inspiration, How Can Digital Marketers Stay Innovative in a World Full of Cliches? Please put your hands up in the air. And with a huge round of applause, let's welcome Mr. Vivek Marani, MD, Magnon EG Plus here on the dais with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Ye renowned binowned kuch hai nahi aisa, it's just I don't know where that was added, but it's really good to be on in a physical event after a very long time. I'm third, and Dr. Anurag, thank you very much. The welcome was very warm and I just couldn't refuse, and I think you have a great first mover's advantage of getting back to the real world, you know, in that sense. So thank you very much for having me over here. I know a lot of you have been sitting down for a long time. So, you know, meri ghadi mein bhi that thing, you've been sitting too long, and when you're in a work from home environment, you could very easily get up and do that. So, you know, I will give you the chance to please stand up, all of you. You can stretch a little bit and move. No, I'm serious. Feel free to, it's good for your health. So, yeah, so okay, so do these stretches. Okay, right. I'm sure the blood circulation starts moving now. Okay, I've switched on my timer, and I have my colleague over here who's also said that you know, I speak a lot. I will do my best to convey what I have to do as fast as possible. All right. Okay, so that's it's a very non-cliché topic, and I felt it was very nice. Thank you. So the topic is very nice. It's not cliché for a change. I felt that was, you know, the good thing. So how do we stay innovative in the world full of clichés? Achha, teen hi button hai. Main sare button daba ke dekh raha hu kaun sa chal raha hai. So if it's not working, it's... Okay. Okay, perfect. So, cliche, lack of original thought. So, how does, you know, and we're surrounded by with a lot of cliches. And how do we break free from that? How do we innovate? How many of you, just for me to get a sense, how many of you over here have been on the agency side in the past or currently are? Okay. Okay, that's just a few hands. How many people, how many of you have been on the brand side, on the marketing side, you know, and who've been asked to do something innovative? Okay, a few more hands. All right. So, you know, innovation tends to be this constant pressure on, you know, on people like us from the agency side who are like, ek idea do ekdam best hona chahiye, kisi ne pehle kiya nahi hona chahiye. And it should fit my brand, and it should make sense, and it should be in line with what's happening in the market, you know. Usually that's the brief. Hum kehte hain, "Are, sir, ma'am, kuch brief to de do." So that's where the original thought comes in, and, you know, and how do you actually start thinking on those lines from there in terms of, you know, what you really need to do, you know, the original ideas that you need to do. So the first cliche is, in the advertising and agency world, the first cliche is get drunk, right? So, jab kyunki jab daru pi ke baat karte hai, to the creativity flows to the fullest, right? It's just not with our generation. You know, I read about this with the Greeks, and they used to do this. The Greeks used to actually, they used to actually take decisions or think of ideas when they were in a state of intoxication. But they also had this rule that when you're drunk, you will think of ideas, but you will pass it in the parliament when you're sane. So, you know, that used to be the practice. So I think that is one of the cliches which is, you know, which surrounds our industry. And that's a visual from Mad Men. And I always wondered, they're always constantly drinking. Unke paas chai coffee nahi hoti hai, they only just drink all the time, you know. But I'm not sure if this is quite sustainable in terms of innovation. So what I'm being inspired by for innovation and thinking of good ideas is, you know, what I'd like to share. The pandemic, you know, made me read a few books around this subject and topic, and, you know, it excited me about getting to know how you can think of better things and what you can do, because, you know, it's a part of my job, a lot of our people back at Magnon to be innovative and to, you know, to think of good ideas. Yeah, sorry, it's a big lag. I'm going to press it, after 1-2 minutes, what is the solution? If it's not, then I'll press it first. Right. So, you know, there's this book called Where Good Ideas Come From. And I was very inspired by this book. And it said something like, you have these slow hunches, you know. And figure it for yourself. You probably would do that also. That you have this idea, kuch to hai, you know, I think I can't crack it, but it's there, something in my mind, right? That's a hunch. And then you have a lot of these slow hunches, right? And over a period of time, these slow hunches, you know, a hunch here, a hunch there, a hunch, kuch hai, but you're unable to kind of tie it together. It happens with me a lot. And, you know, what I try and do is, now I know consciously that, you know, this is how good ideas happen, is it starts with a slow hunch. And whenever this move forward, I will reveal what those slow hunches. I think battery? Or, okay, I'll just keep trying. So these slow hunches eventually, so you have a lot of a cluster of these slow hunches, and when you have a lot of these slow hunches, they start colliding with each other, and dhire dhire, over a period of time, you get this, whoa, okay, now I know what happened. So the slow hunches came together and showed you the full vision, okay. Now it's going back slow also, so. Sorry, I'm just so agency type and so dependent on a presentation, because I think it brings out the, you know, brings out the story. Okay. So now I know that every time I press a button, action will happen. Not now, but maybe in the future. So this slow hunch is a concept, is the first inspiration. So I think I was aware of what this slow hunch is about. And eventually a vision will come up. And, you know, that's the thought of how it is. The vision on this screen also will come up. The next concept, essentially, is something called adjacent possible. Maine button dabaya hai, abhi aa jayega. So adjacent possible is, it's actually by this person called Stuart Kaufman, you know, who's written on biological evolution. That, you know, biological evolution has been, is the biggest innovation in whatever we can imagine, you know, is from atoms to human beings and AI, and, you know, where we've got to. And it's obviously taken billions of years. So biological evolution says that innovation best happens in the immediate vicinity. So, you know, we at times get inspired by technology in a big way, and we figure that the blue area is where we are now,
And those circles that you see on the right side are the future possibilities of everything that's possible. You know, I think one of the points that Sir was talking about is unlimited. Matlab, I'll show you some of the cliches and our mind kind of starts going in those. But innovation best happens which are the most closest adjacent possibles. You know, so from how a giraffe's neck over millions of years became longer because there was evolution of, because it was adapting to the next evolution till a next kind of a animal came into being, you know. So, and that was an innovation, nature's innovation. So ideas also tend to come with these adjacent possibles. I know ye theory hai, I'll try and get a context in terms of a digital marketing piece also eventually in this, you know, in these slides. Now imagine a YouTube in 1990, do you think it would have been successful? There was no internet speed at which we had, the internet penetration was bad, but the concept was great in 1990, but it would have not been successful. Amazon in 2005 was there, was very well there, but it's not the same as it is today. You know, we're getting Amazon packets all the time overnight because the logistics change that, right? So adjacent possibles are, adjacent possible are pieces where you can innovate in the next piece where the surroundings are right and possible, and that's what needs to be done. So that's the second inspiration. The third is, you know, now there are many of these small hunches, those circles that you saw, there are circles in the future. Now, when do you really get a great idea or a good idea, or where do you get it, right? One, you get it inside your brain. Basically, what is the brain? The brain is neurons firing and a network of neurons called synapses and, you know, creating ideas and memories and stories in your mind. That's where, you know, every idea comes from. So inside your brain is the first place where ideas will come from. And of course, outside the world, you know, events and places where, or offices or spaces or people or interaction or networks. So there are networks inside the brain and then there are networks outside the brain, right? And the more your ideas collide with each other as hunches inside the brain, or the more you talk about an idea, you'll probably walk out during lunch and talk about some pieces around, you know, what do you think on this particular topic, or, you know, this campaign, or what you're doing next. So those ideas come together, and that's what will lead to innovation. So those are my three inspirations. And now in the digital marketing space, and that's where, you know, I'll narrow down and not give more gyan on, you know, some of the books that I read on the brain and ideas and stuff. But now on the digital marketing side, we see that we are surrounded by a lot of cliches. There's, you know, people talking about consumer journey, marketing, content, programmatic, VR, segmentation, UGC, you know, visual design, blockchain, AI. Gosh, you know, the words don't end. And why I like this topic was because year on year, you know, there may not be much change happening. I'll take that back. A lot of change is happening. But the number of cliches or the number of keywords that, you know, as a marketer we are shared just keeps increasing. And then it becomes like our pressure to keep up with it. That do we know everything? Oh, if we don't, you know, we'll probably become irrelevant. And, you know, that's the thought that keeps coming to our mind. So now this is like a keyword cloud, and imagine our brain is also like that keyword cloud, and imagine all these individual cliches. You may call it cliche, you may call it just a nomenclature for, you know, a concept like that, but all of them now start gradually coming together. And these are something that we see inside. So let's adapt. So that's the digital space. You saw some of the cliches. Now these inspirations adapted to how you can innovate, and I'll probably talk you through an example that, you know, these were some of the cliches that we as an agency were facing. We work with Nestle. Nestle is one of our you know, clients, and they wanted us to do something innovative. Every client wants us to do something innovative, but this was a particular example that I've picked up where, you know, we needed to do something innovative. So the whole thought started with there's a lot of content around, right? We face this, there's a lot of content around. The last two sessions, I think we were centered around content. There's a lot of content that all of us are consuming. We know this. Now this content is creating something called the messy middle, right? this is, you know, Google came up with this report called Decoding the Messy Middle. And they basically said that the consumer journey is not linear anymore. It's very messy. So the trigger to purchase, now imagine yourselves that when you think of buying something, you are you're influenced by a lot. First, the product shows up on your Facebook, Insta, you know, on Amazon, wherever you've heard about it. So, you know, the product shows up. Then you look at reviews, you read reviews, then you're sent more content, you're remarketed that content, you're given more content. So the brain essentially now is being fed a lot of content, right? And how the brain operates is now not necessarily ki pehle mere ko pata tha, fir maine consider kiya, fir usko jaake purchase kiya. It's become more complicated like that. But to simplify the messy middle, it is that our brain evaluates where, you know, it explores, so you expand your options. So you want to buy a phone, you will look at 5, 6, 7 phones, you look at budget, and then you'll start doing filters, and then you'll narrow down on your options, right? You'll see blogs, you'll read reviews, you'll see what people are saying about it. You'll do a lot of stuff, right? And then you will narrow down your choices, you will evaluate. So this is like an infinite loop. So for people like me, my wife says that about me, that I am a, my decision making is slow. So basically I get lost in this loop. So jab maine socha tha khareedunga aur jab tak khareeda usme bahut time lag gaya, but then I also have a lot of friends who, you know, are able to do this very fast, right? So you go in, you get into this loop. So as a marketer's job or a brand's job, it is to identify those triggers and get people out of the loop to make them buy, right? That's what a marketer is, something that we do. Now, within the same report, Google identified that, you know, there are 6 biases, and this is very interesting, okay? Now figure this out, that all your brains are coded in the same way. That there are 6 biases that will change, that will happen in our mind to drive us to that purchase. The first is a category heuristic, they call it. So, kitne megapixel ka camera hai, in the same example, or, you know, what's the processor speed? Those are things that you will look at. Then you look at, oh, what is Rajiv Makhani saying about it? Or, you know, what is so-and-so expert, which is an authority bias, you know, looking at it. What are my friends talking about it? Or somebody who knows about mobile phones, what is he thinking about it? Is that it's a social influence, a social proof is what I will look for. Power of now, main order karunga, will I get it tomorrow? Oh, this one I'll get after 10 days. No, no, I'll just get this one. It's the power of now, right? A scarcity bias. I'm looking at the time. If that, okay. A scarcity bias. You see those sites? Only 2 left, only 3 left, right? Wo bahut dimag lagaya kisi ne. So it makes us think that, oh my God, it'll run out, right? That's called a scarcity bias, right? And then there's the power of free. Anything I do, I see a lot of cameras have come up. Okay, so it's actually a great report, right? You should read this report by Google. The power of free is what am I getting along with it for free, right? It is a big influencer. So these 6 biases play on our mind. Then we also know video rules. Now this is all cliches, or, you know, these are all things that are playing on our mind when we're thinking about that idea for Nestle. Now, we've also been told that there's a big focus on something called rurban. Is rural plus urban, right? Because bottom of the pyramid in India is rurban. Now, 90% of people coming onto the internet are speaking vernacular, you know, languages. My colleague over here and friend for 15 years, Naved, he heads an agency called Magnon Sankus, which is a group agency, which is only a language specialist agency. So, now there's consumer segmentation in the country. That's how our country is divided. We speak 22 different languages in our country. We probably know this, but, you know, the unfortunate piece is that brands or agencies just speak in English, at best in Hindi, right? But consumers speak all other languages. The, you know, I would say the content ecosystem for news channels is far more evolved than it is on the agency or the brand or the marketing side. Because that evolution is yet to happen. So that's like the kind of consumer segmentation that is, you know, that is there. We also see that regional content is more sticky. You know, so, you know, there's this Kerala-based animation studio which essentially has more views of 600% more views of their Malayalam content versus English content. English content ki to bharmar hai by brands. There's so much of it. Hindi content, there's a lot of it. But regional content is very little because, you know, brands have not yet, they have, but you know, they are increasingly waking up to it. So we realize that, okay, regional content potential. Now, just coming back, I'm just threading where we started. Now, these are all the ideas that are influencing our mind, right? That video, vernacular, regional content, cognitive biases, ye sab bahut gyan to hai. Now, how do we put all of this together, right? And then what we start doing is, zaruri nahi hai sab kuch lena hai. Usme humko AI bhi lagana hai aur blockchain bhi lagana hai. So, you know, it's not really, it's not about just being cool. It's about getting some things right. So we stack a bunch of those thoughts and ideas together. And what we identify is that, okay, let's create video content which is vernacular by regional content creators is the most logical thing that we come up with, right? And from there, so if you're a marketer, you've probably got it by now. You know, we've tied it down together. So say, okay, get regional influencers and marketers. But now we go a step further and we collide with a liquid network. Okay, my time's up. 10 minutes, no? Okay, we collide with a liquid network, and which is Talent Track, which is India's largest talent aggregator of creators, right? And Talent Track has essentially more than 450,000 creators, content creators, sitting out there, 15,000 media companies, you know, looking for talent from there, 5,500 influencers. So we basically work with Talent Track and we say that, listen, this is our idea. What do we do? How do we take this content to the next level? So they give us an idea about what good content is. And they tell us that good content is which is engaging. Now imagine yourself the content that you actually watch. I'll just finish this for the, okay. Is it okay if I take 5 minutes? Or okay, thanks. You know, I indicated to my friend over there, Naved, that if I'm boring everyone, to aise signal kar dena. So abhi tak usne signal kiya nahi hai, so I'll... So content engagement, what I'm talking about, the content engagement and content relevance. So genetics and social hacking, serialized, ab mein aur jyada gyan time nahi hai. So, but basically influencer content mein ek cheez dekhoge, thoda sa wo salesy hota hai. Everybody realizes ye influencer ko paise diye hai, usko bola hai ki ye content dal do, you know, or speak about my brand. Now that is not necessarily good quality content, right? It's not engaging. It's good quality, high quality production value, but high quality brand alignment, but not necessarily good quality content, right? Is video content. So what we came up with this whole concept of professionally user generated content, right? It is not influencer content, it is not fully professional content, but it is content at scale, which is unique, which is non-salesy, which advocates brand love and perpetuity and content with same. And then we put in the biases over there and we say that this is the content which actually has social proof. Kyunki pata hai ki wo paise nahi, brand ne paise nahi diya, it's not salesy. We've got some examples, but I don't think I have time. And then there's the whole brand-led content and influencer content, which kind of doesn't add up. So what do we need to achieve this? You need vernacular capabilities. You know, as somebody, as an agency, if you want to do this for a brand, hyper-local insights and scalability quotient. So we collided our ideas together with Magnon Sankas, which is the language business, hyper-local insights from Magnon Designery, and you know, Talent Track, which got in the scale, because what we needed was more than 200 content creators, right? And I'll give you an example, I'll show you a brief example of how we created video content across 200 video pieces of content for an insight that we got for Milkmaid. So this was for Milkmaid. You guys know the brand Milkmaid. They want to do something interesting. It's baking is like a big trend. But they said baking in every part of the country is different. Us samay, us state mein, us culture mein kya chal raha hai, wo alag chal raha hai. Toh humne insight liya हमने खूब सारे क्रिएटर्स टैलेंट ट्रैक हेल्प्ड अस डू दिस एंड गॉट अस इनसाइट्स फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर द कंट्री फ्रॉम यू नो हंड्रेड्स ऑफ क्रिएटर्स वी गॉट इनसाइट्स फ्रॉम यू नो आवर डिजाइनरी टीम वी पिक्ड अप एंड दिस वाज एन एग्जांपल लाइक दिस इज अ केरला बेकर यू नो समबडी शी अब इन्फ्लुएंसर बेस ज्यादा नहीं है बट कॉन्टेंट इज ऑर्गेनिक राइट ओवर हियर And we created videos and we got to know that Banoffee pie in Kerala is trending at that time, right? And we got her, I don't know if this video will play, but okay, it's in Malayalam. I think there's an audio thing. But you see, there's a very subtle integration of the brand over there, that blue can that you see. And she's not saying much. Malayalam, most of you will still not understand. But, you know, she's just saying, I'm using Milkmaid, and then it's the whole recipe of how to make Banoffee pie in Malayalam. And imagine seeding that kind of content in hundreds is what, you know, we achieved with the brand, and we came up with this whole idea around PUGC is, you know, how we use professional user-generated content, and that, from our mind, was a long-term idea. And we moved from just a cliche to an innovation, and with the journey in between from hunches to creators to, you know, ideas colliding with each other. And then, of course, we had a drink and celebrated. So thank you very much. That's a little bit about our agency. We're a part of the Omnicom group, and EG Plus is Omnicom's largest production hub. We are the India business called Magnon. We were acquired 10 years back. And, you know, those are our three agencies. We're about 350 people here in India. Thank you very much. And